Hello, so welcome back. We are going to now have a look at the actual UART code that I'm writing at the moment to wrap a C interface to a hardware peripheral on an embedded system, in this case UART, in a statically allocated, in terms of memory, way, rather than using the heap or the free store, if you prefer, at all. The intent behind this is for it to be portable, so not specific to UART. So we can use it for SPI, I2C, so on and so forth. It just wraps an interface. We use a few little design patterns, as they're called, to make this elegant, correct, and as short and maintainable and easy to understand as possible. And we use C++ 20 and as much of the compiler's power as we can to make sure that this is going to work at compile time. So it reduces the amount of debugging we have to do at runtime to almost zero because the compiler can tell us whether or not the code is correct. And that is one of the biggest bonuses of C++, is that you can make the compiler do a lot of the hard work for you, which you can't do in earlier versions of the standard, or at least to a lesser degree. This is one of the things that's improving over the years. And in C is very hard, why we need a lot of static analysis stuff. It's not bulletproof, the compiler. So static analysis and tools such as that are still very, very useful, but it gets us halfway there, living on a prayer. So this is what we did last time, the hello world. I'm going to give this a lovely control A delete. In fact, I'm not even going to do that. I'm going to go delete there because this was purely to make sure that the environment we set up was working fine. Nothing else has changed. Task.json is the same as it was in the previous video. This is literally 30 seconds after I hit stop recording. And file, that's just some C++ stuff. Don't really care about C++ extension stuff, should I say. So let us do some codey-wody. Now, to sort of, we're going to be interfacing to a sudo C vendor provided API. I'm not going to import expressifs one into here because it's just not going to compile because of all the cross-linking and dependencies and coupling is the technical word. So I'm just going to make a sudo one, and then we can base it on that. Good thing about that is we can make sure it's our code, our wrapper, I guess, is generic enough. What's it? It's not called a wrapper, it's called a facade. Is generic enough that it's, you know, it can work with different APIs. So let's just quickly do this. Yes, I use Pragma once. If you're not here before, fight me. It's better than include guards in every way. And we're going to do a UART. So typically, or at least in the STM HAL world and in Espressif IDF world, we normally have some sort of enum for the UART ID. And let's say UART0, UART1, and then UART max or invalid. Let's just go with invalid. Okay, so there are global identifiers for which bus we're using. And this is because there's normally multiple different hardware UARTs available on the chip. So on the ESPs I normally use, there's two. On the newer Espressif chips, there's more than two. On some of the STMs, there's like eight or nine. It's insane. You can have software UARTs as well. and so on. But for now, we'll just stick with two because it's all we need to do to prove the point. And then we will have just a nice... Oh, one sec. Nope, don't recognise that one. Static const expert standard size T UART N hardware ports equals, in this case, 2. I wonder if I can just do... Probably makes... Well, it doesn't read as nice as 2, but at least it keeps these two in sync. So... You know what? I'm a dum-dum. I've already covered this off. Huh. So the other way of doing it, because that reads a lot nicer right at the top of the file, is to do a static assert that the UART N hardware ports minus 1 is less than static cast to stud size T of UART ID UART invalid, like that. Does that match? Yeah. So we're making sure that this number, which is 2, is less than this number, effectively. The minus 1 is to stop the off by 1 error, because that is 1, that is 2. Actually, as you can see, the enum, we start counting at 0. Fairly standard stuff there, hopefully. I'm not going to bother implementing them. So we're going to have some sort of config. And let's just sort of inspire this from the ESP one. So we're going to have a board. And let's just default that. We're going to have bits, we're going to have parity checking, I don't think I've ever had that on, we're going to have stop bits, I don't think I've ever seen that, not one, we'll have flow, bool flow control, pretty much never have that on. And that's going to be our config. What's this having a... It's not... We've not got access to standard size T. Well, let's give it access to standard size T by including C standard int. Stop you moaning now. Now, we do want to include a comparison operator so we can see if two configs are identical. This will be very useful later on. And we can use a really funky thing about C++20 here. So we can make this const expert. It's going to return a bool. It's going to be an operator. And it's going to be the spaceship operator, as they colloquially call it. And it's going to take a UART config. Now there's two ways of doing this. I'm going to do it the global way, so make this a friend, and it takes two UART configs, the one left and the one right of the operator, and we can do this, which is lovely. We can hit default. Now in C++17 you would have had to use standard tie to make that work, or the other way of doing it, which is probably more likely what you're going to see in a lot of code bases, is something like this. Let's tell you what, let's do it in the same fashion as a friend function, first and second. return first dot board equals second dot board and first dot bits equals second dot bits. You see where this is going. This is getting tedious already. And so on, right, for each of these to make an operator equals equals. That also gives you not operator not equals for free, which is quite useful. So at least you only need to declare it once. But then someone comes along and goes, oh, I want another member here that is, you know, is hardware instance. Bad example. But they don't see this function hidden away down here. They don't add it in. So now this is not getting checked in here. So that could be different, but it's still returning equality. That's bad. Very, very bad. This is very unmaintainable. So if you're stuck in C++17, at least use standard tie. That just solves a lot of issues. But you've got to say that is just beautiful. It gives you all the comparison operators. So less than, greater than, equals to, not equals to, greater than equal, less than equal to. All in this, and it's defaulted. No maintainability required. I can add more and more stuff here, and each time we compile, it just sorts itself out. Beautiful, love it. Brilliant, can't wait. So the last things we need are now the implementations. Now, I'm just doing this in a header file, so I'm going to have to make them inline. If you don't know what inline does, this is one that's often misdescribed. All member functions declared, or should I say, implemented in a header file, or declare, I always get declared and defined the wrong way around. Defined in a header file are marked in line for you. However, free functions are not. This is a free function. What it does is slightly different. In this case, it guarantees So therefore, inline in a class is a hint to the compiler that we should eliminate the function call, and instead you should copy and paste the body into the call site. So we get rid of a function call, a level of creating a stack frame and so on and so forth, just copy and paste it in. It's a hint to the compiler is free to and often does completely ignore it. So there's 0 point in putting inline in a class member declaration. Free functions are different. Inline has a different meaning. It means that there will only be one definition of this function, even though this header file might be included by lots and lots of different translation units, which is very useful, because if you have a static mutex in here but this function is not in line, then each different translation unit that gets it is going to have its own version of this function, which will have its own static mutex. So this does not do what you think it will do across all the translation units. However, if you make it inline, it guarantees that there is only one version of this function, and therefore there will only be one version of this static mutex. That is like it's just huge. You really do need to understand that. This is just going to return true. We'll do a D in it. So let's just copy and paste these down for the moment, just to save a bit of typing. So there's going to be a DNet function. So this is what you would typically see in the IDF or in the STM32 HAL abstraction library, hardware abstraction library, should I say. And let's just do a send and a receive for now. There will be more functions than this, but to prove a point, we don't necessarily need them now. And these typically take a UART ID. So which bit of hardware are we talking to? And that gives you your offset to your registers normally. Maybe not an offset, it's maybe done through a switch case in the API, but whatever. The send is going to take some constant UN8s. My dear, there we go. And then it's probably, we'll stick with the ESP implementation, which I believe takes a UN16. Short, I think that is, but we'll stick to the slightly more verbose. Yeah, short. Unsigned, obviously. So there's your pointer and length. And that this is typically what you will get in an API, a C API. And then, likewise, the receive is probably going to be very, very similar. The difference being that won't be const, because this is an out pointer and length. So that's probably going to be passed in by reference. Which doesn't exist in C, so it can't be passed in by reference. I'm a dum-dum. So yeah, this function will write to that buffer and also change the length to what it actually was. That's slightly different to my notes, so that's going to throw me off. So what are we going to do in these functions? Well, I'm just going to copy and paste my notes into here, and then I'll just quickly talk, because it'll just save a little bit of time, because this really doesn't actually matter. Because this is a dummy implementation anyway, and then we need a few headers just to support what I've written here. Okay, let's talk about it. Chronoliterals, we actually saw that in the last video. That just allows you to do 1 ms for 1 millisecond, and that converts it into the correct type, which is an unsigned long in this case, and blah blah blah. Makes time very, very easy to use using standard cout. So we're just going to say, look, someone called this function, and actually we can do this even better. We can use a macro. Yes, I am using a macro. You won't see that often, but this one's quite good. As you can see, it's just the name of the function. That's a provided one for you. One of the few that are fine to use, in my opinion. So yeah, we print out the function name to UART, and then the ID of the UART that was passed in. So that gives us our instance in hardware. And then we will loop through each of, for the total length, the pointers. Static cast them to an int. You know what, let's just change the name of that so it matches my notes. Static cast them to an int and tab separate them, print them all off. But after each print, we're just going to stop for a millisecond. This will make sense later down the line, but this slightly emulates the fact that the processor has got to clock these bytes out, and that takes time and can't just be done at 4 GHz, because the UART is 11.5200 baud or whatever we've set it to. So it just adds a bit of delay, which is interesting because it allows for a bit of task switching, context switching. May not be relevant if you are doing a DMA send, because then that happens on a separate bit of hardware. So you just fill the buffer as quickly as you can in DMA, and then you go on and do something else, and a different part of the microprocessor will then start clocking all this data out for you in the background, not taking up your instruction time. But anyway, once we've clocked all of that out to the terminal, we'll do a new line, return true. Okay, receive slightly different. Same, we'll just log that the function's been called. And then what we'll do is we'll do standard IOTA, which just fills an integer sequence of numbers into the buffer, starting at the number 16. So it'll go 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 24, however long the length is. And because I've made that an out variable there, we have to do a deref on that. And you know what, let's just do if len is greater than 2, to just prove the point that we're changing it. So we've received one less byte than the buffer that we put in, and we've changed that, so that is now an out variable, so the caller will see that this variable has changed, this length variable, and then we're going to fill the buffer with those len minus 1 bytes, starting at 16 in this case, and that needs to be deref'd as well. Just to prove that, you know, you pass in a bigger buffer than the data you get back. That's the only reason I've done that. And that's our API. Okay, fine, we can sort of forget about this now. So at this point, we can start looking at how we want to interface to the hardware. And we're going to use a design pattern. Well, we're going to use injection that allows a bit of compile time polymorphism in a way. So all scary words if you're not used to those words, but hopefully you'll see that it is quite elegant and quite nice, and hopefully easy to understand if I can do my job properly. So let's just make a few files first. And then we'll do something with them. Is that the three I wanted? Yes, it is. And then we actually need to make our main. And we're going to start with main, because this is pretty much what we want, defines what we want to do. So let's do an int main, let's do a hash include c standard def set up the boilerplate, there we go. Okay, so what we want to be able to do is make an instance of our UART by some call to, let's say, get UART, and we want to pass it our UART ID. So just to get rid of the squiggles on this, yeah, whatever, IntelliSense. Let's just go ahead and include, we'll be able to get rid of this in a moment, the API. So this is the Espressif API, for example. And let's just get rid of that. Bool get UART. So this is just dummy code for a moment, just to sort this out. And we're going to give it the UART ID. Something like that. And then we're going to do return ID less than, sorry, ID not equal to UART ID, UART invalid, return true, otherwise return false. So just a crude thing there, just to get rid of our squiggles here. So I should be able to just run that. And our survey says, too few arguments, very good point, well made. Let's say we want our UR0 instance. Expected a semicolon. Unused variable. Oh, it's because I put a colon there, not a semicolon. Anyone spot that? And there we go. So, only warning is that this isn't used. Okay, excellent. Now, what do I want to be able to do with this? Well, I want to be able to copy it. Is a good start, because this might get sent off to some function to do some work, or sent off to some threads. So I want to be able to, so UART copy is equal to UART. I want to be able to copy it, get another instance, but we're using the same hardware underlying. So although we've got two instances in our code now, they both refer to the same underlying implementation. They still call the same functions send with UARID of 0 in this case. Okay, that should hopefully be fairly trivial and we can understand probably how that works. But what if another bit of code in a completely different translation unit wants its own UART instance, doesn't know about these two at all, and does one of them? This needs to all be the same thing, even though these are in completely different translation units, for example. So this lends itself to two different design patterns, either the singleton or the mono state. Now, singleton is where we have something like, let's say, int get UART 0 static int I equals 0, return I, get UART 1, and I'm just doing an integer here rather than an object or anything. And then what we can do here is Turn this into a switch. And do a case. And then we'll return that visible get UART 0. Get UART 1 and we'll return minus 1 here. No, we won't. We'll break here. And we'll return minus one here, just by way of example. And we could prettify this a little bit if we so wish. Like that. So, if we're trying to get a UART, we return a static instance. This is the singleton pattern. Personally, I don't like it. Why? Well, what happens if we now have move to a different chip that has three UARTs? Well, now I have to go in, I have to maintain this, I have to copy and paste, which is bad, but I have to change all of this. Then I realize it won't compile because there's an unhandled case in this switch statement, so I have to go and change this switch statement to return UART 2. Oops, typo there, that's why I got a squiggle. And then we move to another chip that you see straight away this starts getting quite messy. Probably template this if you wanted to make it a little bit more pretty. But personally, I'm not a big fan of the singleton pattern. It has its uses where it is the right thing. But sometimes there's a better way. So we're going to use the monostate pattern. If you are into your design patterns, then hopefully that makes sense. If not, you'll learn it through this. So what we can do is have a look at the interface that we're going to use to achieve what we just suggested in that sort of pseudo code. First of all, let's make a namespace to do all this in. And let's call it UART, and then that stops us needing to put UART in front of every single thing we type, which gets very tedious after a while. And let's make an interface class. Now, what is this interface going to need to take from the user in order to construct it? Well, hopefully this should be fairly straightforward. It's going to need to take a UART ID for which one the user wants us to use, because that's going to be coupled to the pins, and actually pins should probably be in the UART config here, but anyway, we'll leave it as it is for now. And it's going to need to take a config. And we can even be clever, I say clever, this could be dangerous, and default argument that as well. So if the user doesn't specify a config, then we'll just use the default, which are these default variables here. And to just get rid of the squiggles, let's include the header. There we are. Now, what's this going to need to do? It's going to need to check if this ID is already constructed somewhere. If so, make a copy. No, if so, check the config is the same. If not, error, because we can't instantiate the same hardware UART with two different configs at the same time, makes no sense. If yes, or if so, return a copy to the same instance. And if it's not already constructed, construct it. So that's what this needs to do. So we'll come back to that. Now, because you can't return anything from here, and we're most likely going to have exceptions turned off, actually that should be something I have in my tasks. F no exceptions, like that, just to make sure that is turned off. Very rarely have them on in embedded. The way they are at the moment, they use far too much memory. For bare metal, at least. So you can't return anything from here. You could throw an exception if, in this case, but we're not going to have exceptions turned on. So we need another way of checking whether whatever we got constructed here is valid. The bool operator is sort of pretty reasonable for this. So we can do operator bool, which is going to be const because it doesn't modify the underlying thing. Return what? Well, we need to return whether or not it was validly created. So let's just do a bool is valid. This is placeholder, by the way, it's not going to stay like this. And do something like that. So now we can do, let's default this and say is valid equals false. Oops. Is valid equals true. And is valid equals true, probably. So there, you know, the three pathways it can take. Now we need three functions. We need a way to initialize, and this may end up being called by the constructor. Now, there's a problem here. Do we want to just directly call API UART init? No, definitely not. Why? Because, well, what if this is a copy of an already existing instance? We don't want to call the API to init it because it's already inited. We could have a static member variable here to say that we're already initialized, but then that doesn't work across different IDs. So we might need a map of IDs to, starts getting messy. Okay, you can see the rabbit hole we're going down. So we'll think about this in a different way. We're gonna have a handle to the actual implementation. So the implementation is separate from this interface. So we're going to have, see how I can do this in bits. So this is very much a to-do, but so let's just make it an int for now. just call it H. And it's probably going to be a pointer. Is it going to be a pointer? No, it's probably not, because it's going to be owning. So it's going to be something like this. Ignore that line. That is just to make sure we don't get the squiggles and this will compile. We're going to come back in when we've actually done an implementation class and replace this. And now we can actually get rid of this is valid, because we can ask the handle if it is valid. So we can do, oops, and this is going to start giving me squiggles now, unfortunately. Handle will probably be implemented actually as a pointer. And actually, if we've got the handle, then it is valid. Whereas if it is a null pointer, then it's probably not valid. So actually, that won't give us the squiggles nicely. So now we can call h init. In it, and the implementation will decide whether or not that is required, and we may end up just being able to get rid of these altogether, which would be lovely. And we need a send and receive function, because that's what the user is going to need to be able to talk to this. So let's do that. So remember back to the old video when we did some stuff on spans. We're unlikely to be ever sending a single character. And a span is a nice containerized way of putting a buffer and a length in the same argument. Has lots and lots of benefits, but it gets rid of a lot of bugs. So we're going to need, and let's just say it returns a bool for now, because I think that's how the API did it. Yeah, it returns a bool on success, I guess. We're going to take a standard span of some const data, which can be anything. We don't actually care what it is, because we're just going to clock it out as bytes anyway. So we don't care what the data type is, so we know where this is going. So now we're not limited to only being able to send UINTs and having to do dirty casts and so on and so forth. We can actually just say, look, the user just wants to clock stuff out, whether it's a const char, whether it's a string, whether it's an array of ints or an array of longs or blah blah blah, it doesn't matter, they just want to send the stuff. And we can handle the conversion to what the API requires down the line. The user doesn't need to worry about that, they don't need to mess it up and get it wrong and get alignment wrong or endianness wrong. We can have that in a configuration somewhere. So that looks good. So we're going to then send, or at least return, after we send it to the handle. And the handle is, or the implementation is going to take exactly the same thing here. It's going to take the data. Now, we can do a little bit more cleverness on this that is worth doing. If someone calls this with, what are we, iface, so just call it x, and then does x dot send, and then does an r value, so let's do const char hello This is sudo code anyway. Hello. And then we do a standard span of const char. Sorry, mouse is in the way. Of hello. This is an R value. It's not named. It doesn't have a name. So, but here it has a name. So this is going to have to be constructed, passed into here. That there's an efficiency, I mean, in respect to this bad example, because it's actually quite cheap to do in this case, but we can actually do better and inform the compiler that no, we don't actually need an L value here, a named variable. You can just pass it all the way down a single instance. You don't need to move it, you don't need to copy it, just use the single definition, and it gets thrown away afterwards. And the way we do that is, and interestingly I don't have the header in this, just noticed a mistake, is using standard forward. And what standard forward does is it retains the reference types. Sorry, let me just type this in first before I try and explain something that's slightly complicated. It's in the utilities header. And then let me do one of these. So we'll do a standard forward of the data, and we need to oh, you suck. Standard forward of the data, that worked. And the type is a std span of const t's. Like that. So now, if data is an L value, a name thing that gets passed in, it stays an L value. If it's an R value or a forwarding reference, double ampersands or whatever it is, what standard forward does is makes sure that the type stays as that as it goes all the way down the chain. Hopefully that makes sense. This is probably not a very good example because of the way we're doing this. I do need to check it. But that's sort of the logic that's going on. So that pertains to this. Yeah, it should pass down fine. I'm just wondering if that whole thing needs to be T, that's all. I will check that for next time. And we can do our receive exactly the same, differences it's not const, and of course we need a receive, something like that. Now the user might want to, for whatever reason, get some information back out, for example the ID and the config. So let's just copy those in from my notes, and that's going to be stored within the implementation that we're going to pass through this constructor that we've got yet to do. And we can just pass that back up if, for whatever reason, the user decides they need it. And that is pretty much the interface done, or the facade design pattern. So let's save that. So we need to come back to this once we've got the implementation done, so that we can actually figure out how it's going to work. So let's have a look at that implementation then. Did I put... Yes, I did. So let's do one of those. We're going to need the API just so we can get the names. This will get tidied up very soon, which should be nice. We want to be in the UART namespace. And you know what I haven't done? I quite like doing that. Because you're like, what's this stray bracket? There we go. Now we know what that stray bracket is. So we're going to have our implementation. Impl. So why have I done? Oh, I see. Right, okay. Yeah. So we know some of the things that this is going to have already because of what we've just done, and we've defined in the interface that the implementation is going to have the ID, it's going to have the config, it's going to have a receive, a send, dinit, and an init, and some way of constructing. So we can add some of those in right off the bat. And I'll just copy this in just for brevity. So it's going to have the ID, it's going to have the config. So makes this a nice composition. It's not going to be default constructible because that makes absolutely zero sense, because it needs to be tied to a bit of hardware. So we need to, you know, it makes no sense having a UART implementation that has no config or ID. It doesn't compute. So our constructor is going to look something like that. So we'll pass in the ID and the config. That will then construct our in-place construct our ID and config that we've got stored in the class. These shouldn't really be public, because if someone changes that, they may think they've changed it, but actually they haven't if the API call hasn't been done. And we have here the call to init, which does mean that we can get rid of this call to init, because it's the implementation's responsibility to make sure that the hardware is initialized. And this is where you see the little pattern we did before, where we'll have this initialize variable defaults to false, but we call init here. Now our destructor is nice and simple. If we're initialized, call dinit, and actually setting this get optimized the way it's not really relevant actually. I can probably just get rid of it. Because the whole object's getting destroyed anyway, so it doesn't really do anything. I don't know why I wrote that. Forgot I was in a destructor, clearly. So they're these. We now need an init and a dinit statement. Function, member function. And these are quite simple. So let's do a bool init, because we sort of know what this is going to do. This is the implementation, so this is where the API gets called. So we're just going to call the API. There we are. Now then, we know we're going to have multiple instances of this. We know that they could be running across two different threads. They could even be running across two different cores. So we can't have two threads or two cores executing this at the same time. That is bad, to put it gently. So we need to protect this. And to do that, we can use a mutex for mutual exclusion. And let's just copy this over, actually. And there's our mutex. Now, you will quite often see the keyword mutable used in front of a mutex. That means that if there is a const instance of this, then despite this being const, this mutex is modifiable. So if you're calling a function that doesn't actually change this class in any way, but you need to access the mutex in order to check something, to read, because we're reading it as read-only because it's const, but you need to make sure that you get the mutex first to make sure no one else is writing what you're trying to read, you need to change the state of the mutex. But you're const, so you can't change the state of anything because it's const. So mutable overrides const here, which is just a bit of a brain melter. But hopefully that will sort of make sense. And then we need to actually use it. So we use the lock. We'll make a scoped lock. This is using RAII, resource acquisition is initialization. So we create a lock on the stack using the mutex, and this will take the lock, and it will block until the lock is taken. And then when we return, we lose our scope, so this gets destroyed, and that will automatically release the lock. The release is done in the destructor. Just like in our destructor here, we're doing our D init. Okay. Now we need a send and receive. Now hopefully you're still following this, but you're thinking, well, hang on a minute, what if we have multiple instances of this? Isn't it going to destroy? No, we won't. We will only have one implementation instance per hardware. This is going to be controlled somewhere else in the hardware interface, but there will only be one implementation instance per hardware port. And when it's created, we initialize, and when it's destroyed, we DNet. And that will be done by resource counting, instance counting. So we need a send and receive function. So let's do the send together. This is going to look fairly familiar. Standard span const t data, which means this is a template. We know what we're returning because we're returning the API call. Or the result of, should I say. In fact, let's just copy that whole thing in. So we're returning the result of this. Our ID we know. So bang, straight away, that's done. But now we need to get a UIN8 pointer and a length from this standard span. So let's do that. So let's do a const UIN16, which is our length. And that is a really, really nice feature in standard span where we can actually get the length in bytes. Which if the span, or if type T here is a char or a UIN8 or an int8 or a standard byte, whatever, then size and size bytes is going to be the same number. But if this is ints, depending on your platform, 32-bit, for example, will be four times the size, because the span is how many ints you've got, but size bytes, because each int is four, it's going to be four times the size. But this this function is just brilliant. Love it. This returns a size type, standard size type, which on most embedded platforms is a 32-bit number. We know that UIN16 is not 32-bit, it's not the size type. So what happens if our length our size in bytes is more than, what is it, 65536, something like that, uint 16 max, we've got a problem because we've just overflowed our length. So we need to handle that. So if this is less than or equal to uint 16 max, should I forget which header that's in? Hash include C standard int, I think. Might be in standard def. Anyway. So we're going to check that. If it is less than or equal to uint 16 max, then we can hold it. In which case, not a problem. So what we will do is we will static cast to a uint 16. And we know this is safe to do because we've checked that it is, we can hold it in a uint 16. Do some of that. Let's just do a bit, one of these. If not, we'll return zero. So, if we have 0 bytes to send, it's less than uint 16, we'll get zero. This makes no sense, we'll handle that in a minute. If we have more bytes to send than we can fit in a uint 16, because the API can only send up to 65535 or whatever, uint 16 max, 65533, thank you in hex, lovely, then we can't send it. We can't send what the user asked us to send. We could possibly send it in two chunks. Can't be bothered to implement that at this time. So we've got two cases we need to handle, where we're trying to send too much data or we're trying to send zero data. And helpfully, because of this conditional, on both cases, len will be zero. So if not len, return false, always. We fail to send, you gave us shit data. You didn't give us any, or you gave us too much. Not doing it. Goodbye. Try again. Easy peasy. Okay, receive function, very, very similar. Let's copy and paste that in. Takes a span again, this time not const, because we're going to be writing into the thing that the user passed us. Sanity check on the length of this buffer that we were passed. Make sure it's not zero. And then we're going to return, why have we got a scope mark there and not there? I've been a dum-dum. We don't want to be calling the API at the same time from two different threads, so please scope lock that. Oh, it is in my notes, I just didn't type it because I'm an idiot. So same check on the length. If you've not given us a buffer, so put it in, or the buffer is... You know what? Or if the buffer is too big, technically isn't an issue. It isn't an issue, is it? No, because we can just pass in uint 16 max. And I do need to make that not const as well. Yeah. So if the number of bytes is less than uint max, then use that number, else use that number. which we could also do in a much better way. Have we got utility? Much, much better way of doing this. Standard min of that and that. Makes much more sense. If the length of our buffer is zero, then we're going to return because we haven't got anywhere to put the data, even if we wanted to. It can't be more than UINT16 max, but if you give it, for some reason, some extortionately large buffer, then fine, you've probably got other issues, but we can only fill up to that much of it anyway. We can pass in our ID, I'll come back to this in a moment, and we pass in the address of our length. And at the moment, because if you remember, this length gets written to with the actual number of data. At the moment, I'm now not passing that back up because I've just made that change for my notes. So we'll have a think about that. Now, the data is interesting because the type of the pointer is this T type, but the API expects a UIN8 star. So we have to, and we should, use reinterpret cast here. The old hated reinterpret cast that you should never ever use. This is one of those few instances where, yes, it is correct to use it. And the only proper way of doing it is to use it, because we want a pointer, a byte pointer, to the start of this data, which you can't ordinarily get another way without doing a reinterpret cast. We know our lengths are correct because we've done that and we've checked it and so on. We've checked it with the size bytes, blah blah blah. So that is a correct use of reinterpret cast, albeit a scary one. Now that is our implementation. Really, really nice and simple for this. Really, really lovely. Now, what needs to be done? The important thing now is we need to make sure that this import is only instantiated once per hardware ID, UART ID here. It must only be instantiated once. No matter how many interfaces get created, they must all refer back to the same implementation, assuming they are using, that they are conforming to this that we wrote down, so it is the same ID using the same config. It also must not clash, so two UART IDs must have their own individual instances. So if you remember, UART0 will have an instance and only one, and UART1 will have an instance and only one, and this will not, obviously. And when the very last instance of the interface for UART0 gets destroyed, then this implementation can be destroyed as well, which we'll call DNet. But if someone else still holds some sort of interface somewhere that refers to UART0, even when one person gets rid of their instance, it must not destroy UART0, because someone else still holds a copy to this. And hopefully you can see where this is going. This is where our reference counting comes in, and we'll be using a shared pointer to implement this from the standard library. And this will be our hardware interface. This is also where the really nice generic part comes in, because the hardware interface will have nothing to do with UART. It will be purely a wrapper around some sort of implementation, in this case, this implementation, but it could be a completely different implementation. We could have a namespace SPI, and in here have a class import. We'll use exactly the same instance controller to make sure that there is only one instance for SPI0, one instance for SPI1, and so on and so forth, even though there can be multiple interfaces across translation units, across cores, so on and so forth. We'll do that next time. This is a nice gap. This gives us our top level how we're going to use our UART, how it gets controlled and the instances get managed. Remember when we did the sudo code at the start, being able to copy it, instantiate it across multiple translation unit boundaries and so on. That's the goal. That's what we're going to do. And we'll do the peripheral wrapper next time. I have an interview in a few minutes, so that's why I'm sort of hurrying up a little bit. But yeah, next time we'll do the wrapper. It's a little bit more complicated, I guess. It'll be using the monostate pattern as well, so we've used a few patterns here, and you'll also see where the injection comes in as well. It's really interesting and elegant stuff, but hopefully you can see that this is quite elegant already. You know, there's very little code. I mean, to maintain this, then this is just an interface, so it's calling other things, fine, point taken. But the implementation is very tidy, converting from any span across any data, a standard string, a C array, a standard array, whatever it is, doesn't matter, it all goes through the same implementation. And it's very maintainable. I like this a lot. Let me know your comments down below. Look forward to the hardware interface stuff and see you in that video. Bye-bye.